Szeretek nyelveket tanulni. YouTube, good morning to everyone there. All right, a week went by that quick. You know what it's time for. It's time to answer some questions here from last week. So as usual, I'm going to go ahead and read these questions here from last week's video and then answer them as thorough as I can. So the rule is, if you have a question, post it in this video that I'm going to post, and then I'm going to answer it next week. All right. Okay. Without further ado, let's get to it. I have a lot of questions here. Let me see. So I'm not going to limit the number of questions. I'm just going to go down, start from the beginning and work my way down here. Let me see. Okay. Palabras electrizantes. I think he, yeah, this is the same guy asked me something last week. But okay, here we go. Hey man, I couldn't believe you answered my question. This really made my day. Thanks a bunch. What course did you use for Japanese? I would love to know and then use that one as well. Greetings from Switzerland, where it's pretty cold at the moment. Okay. So, thanks again for your question. I'm going to call you Palabra. Palabra. I'm going to shorten that up a little bit. So, Japanese, see, that's a language that I started learning around the same time I started learning Chinese. So the resources that I was using back then were a bit different from the ones that are available now, the ones that you can get like Asimail, Teach Yourself. See, I was unaware of those type of courses back in the day. But I remember for Japanese, when I started learning, I got a phrase book similar to the phrase book that I have for Chinese. Then I got this one course. It was called Let's learn and listen to Japanese or something like that. It came with the audio cassette, and those are really the only two resources I had. I was using some other courses for learning the hiragana and the katakana. I can't remember, unfortunately, I can't remember what courses those were, but yeah, as far as formal course, I just had a phrase book, I had a dictionary, and I had that Let's Learn and Listen to Japanese. That's what I had. And that was really, those were really the only resources that I had. And as time went by, once I became aware of different resources such as Teach Yourself and Japanese, this grammar book called Shalm's Grammar, Japanese Grammar by Shalm's, I got that. That was my first grammar book. That was very useful. Then I got Teach Yourself and Asimail, but that wasn't until later. I mean, like when I say later, I mean like 2-3 years later. So, yeah. So my early, when I first started, I didn't have any of the well-known resources that you can get these days. Let me see. Are there? Oh, you asked me something else. I would also like to know how you got the ball rolling when you had 0 subscribers and 0 views here on YouTube. How did you deal with this fact, and how did you increase the amount of views? How did you find your interested audience? Thanks in advance. Wow, you have a lot of questions here, but hey, so it's all good. It's all good. That's a great question, man. Really, it started with I have a friend, a buddy, who I met on Yahoo. I met him through Yahoo Instant Messenger a long time ago. This was like a year after learning Japanese. He was learning Japanese as well. I just met him randomly in a Yahoo chat room, because those are the chat rooms that I hung out in and back in the day. And he introduced me. His name is Dyron, by the way. I can't remember his last name, but his name is Dyron. If you're watching this video, Dyron, I'm gonna actually tag you in this video, and then you can comment and you can tell people about more about this. But yeah, I met him in the Yahoo chat room, and like we stayed in contact for a while, and then he introduced me to this one website called Unilang. It was basically a forum where a lot of language enthusiasts post at, and I was there. I had an account there, and I was posting a lot of language stuff. And they had a little small chat room there. I didn't use it that much, but he told me about that. He's like, yeah, you should come over and you know, you should register on that website. So I did. And I was posting stuff. And then like later he told me, he's like, you should create a YouTube channel. And see, I didn't know much about YouTube at first. I didn't even know what it was. And I asked him what was YouTube. And then he explained to me, he sent me some videos. And I said, oh, and I told him, I said, I don't know if I could do that, like get a camera and, you know, because I was always to myself, very introverted. And he said, yeah, it will be good. He said, you could try it out. And it took me about a month. I thought about it. I said, you know what? I could make some videos, practice some languages, get some feedback from native speakers or whatever. And, you know, I can try that out, see how it goes. And I tried it. I went out and got a camera, got me a little tripod, and you know, it wasn't the best quality, but I wasn't really trying to make quality videos. I was just trying to put the languages out there and get feedback from native speakers. So I did that. I think I started making, I think Korean was the first video, Chinese. I made some spoken practice videos there. I did some Bulgarian. And like I said, I was totally unfamiliar with YouTube. I didn't have like a goal, like I want to reach these type of people. I want to do this. I didn't even have any plans. I just turned the camera on and just started making videos. And then like I noticed that my email, I was getting like a week later, I was getting like a whole bunch of comments, and I didn't know where they were coming from. And a lot of people were subscribing and stuff. And you know, at first I didn't respond, because it was kind of like, okay, whatever, you know, some people are watching, you know. But it started getting really bad. So I said, you know what, I'm gonna start responding to some of these people. And then I just got in the habit. I was making videos left and right. It was ridiculous how I was making those videos. I can't remember the exact numbers when I first started, but the numbers were going up really fast. And then I got contacted by some notable polyglots in the community and notable teachers and whatnot. And they reached out to me and they introduced me to a website, some other website for them. And that gave me another boost. And from there, it was just unbelievable, because I didn't expect that attention. I just, like I said, at first I was a bit reluctant on doing that, because I'm to myself. I'm very introverted. So I felt a certain way of getting a camera and trying to talk, just sit there, talk to the camera by myself. But, you know, as time went by, I got used to it. And I said, you know what, this is good. You know, it got fun. And I had to deal with trolls and stuff like that. But, you know, that's part of the process when you first starting a channel. Anytime you're putting yourself out there in the mainstream media, or not, I said mainstream media. Anytime you're putting yourself out there in social media, you have a YouTube or anything, you're going to get some people. You have to deal with trolls. And I had to deal with that for a while. And it bothered me for a little bit, but I got used to it. You know, I developed this thick skin that people talk about. I don't get offended at all. Like it could be racial, anything. I don't feel anything when people make those comments now, because I had dealt with that so much on a daily basis. And it's just like now I don't take, like when people post like certain things, I try to keep my videos very positive. I try to keep my comment section very clean and not dirty. And when I see dirty things going on, it's time to clean up, take the trash out. That's what I do. And that's my motto here on YouTube. I keep that motto. But that's how I started, man. And it was just, like I said, I didn't have a goal. And maybe if I had a goal, it would have been smoother. But, you know, I don't have any regrets on how I did it when I first started, you know. So, all right, I don't want to make this reply too long. You asked another question. Are there teach yourself courses with no English for languages that are intelligible in regard to your native language? If yes, what is the series called? I believe so. Some ASIMIL courses, there's no English, and some ASIMIL courses is like French, and like, for example, if you want to learn Chinese, they have like French to Chinese, stuff like that. And I believe they have some other courses, but they're in German and German and French. I don't know the names of those courses though, but yeah, those do exist. I know thanks to you, and thank you for that there's two versions of Vietnamese. I want to learn Korean. Is there only one version, or does a Northern and Southern Korean exist? Well, yeah, the Northern, you only have to worry about one version of Korean, the one that's spoken in South Korea. And all the resources that you're going to get, they're going to be mainly South Korean specific. As far as North Korean, they do have their own language. Those resources are scarce. You have to really search for them. But I don't think you have to worry about learning North Korean unless you plan to go there. That shouldn't be a problem. So it's not like Vietnamese, whereas Vietnamese, you have this. I've had a dilemma for a while on choosing like the Northern and Southern accent, and both of those accents are spoken here, but Southern is more common. It's more common dialect spoken here in the U.S. But Korean is not like that. You don't have to worry about it. Everywhere you go in the States and you hear Korean, it's going to be pretty much South Korean. South Korean. You may have some slight like dialect pronunciation, like area specific, like Busan or, you know, some places like that. But for the most part, you don't have to worry about like major changes in the language. Okay. All right. Thanks for your question, Palabra. It's going to be a long video today. Okay. Next question by Erica S. I wanted to ask this for a long time. Finally got the courage. How long do you stay on a language? Thanks for your question, Erica. Great question. How long do I stay on a language? I stay on a language until I've reached my goal. That's why it's important to set goals. Depending on the language, some language I would choose. How can I say it? Once I reach my goal, I won't really be studying that language actively. For example, if I choose a language that I only want to be A2 in, I won't be doing it actively. I'll just speak it, just find opportunities to speak it and practice through chat and whatnot. If it's a higher goal, then obviously I'll be on it longer. But that's how I determine how long I stay on language once I reach my goal. That's why it's very important to set goals so you won't be all over the place and you'll be indecisive when it comes to learning different languages. So once I reach my goal, then I don't be active with that language anymore. Okay. Moses. Okay. Thanks for your question, Erica. Let me see. Thanks for your question. If you have any other questions, post below in this video that I'm going to release, and I'll answer next week. Next video is by Iron Life TV. Moses, how many languages are you fluent in? Okay, thanks for your question. Appreciate it. And this is a very common question. Now, this type of question, what language are you fluent in? I'm really careful when people ask me this. Okay. And everybody has their own definition of what fluent is. I like to be safe and say that I can, obviously I'm fluent in English because that's my native language. Chinese, you know, I'm not native in Chinese, but I consider myself fluent in that language because of how comfortable I am in that language. Of course, there are some things I don't know, but for the most part, when I get in front of a native speaker, I'm able to handle myself in a fluently manner. Japanese, I would consider myself proficient in that language. I'm not as good in that language as I am in Chinese, but I am pretty proficient in Japanese, considering that's one of the languages that I spend a lot of time with over the years. I haven't had much exposure as I had with Chinese, with Japanese, but I can definitely say that I feel pretty proficient when I speak the language. It's just, you know, there's some improvements needed, just more exposure and whatnot, but yeah. So those Chinese and Japanese, I would say those are my most fluent languages. Now, I can converse. Now, when it comes to regular conversation, some people don't really count that as being fluent in language. You know, I don't really care. You know, I don't care if I'm fluent or not. It doesn't matter. As long as I'm able to speak with someone and have some conversation with them, that makes me happy. This is not a race for me. I'm not trying to be in a competition with anybody. I don't care about being fluent or not fluent. It doesn't matter to me. But a lot of the languages I can converse in, I would say at least 20 languages I can speak, like as far as having a fluid conversation with. I'll say at least 20 of them I can. Some of them I'm probably a little rusty, but from not practicing a whole lot. But once I get in the groove, I start practicing for a day or two, then I start coming back to where I was before. But definitely at least 20 of those I can do that in. Now, as far as how many languages I've studied, I've touched, I'll say 50 languages, about 50. It's probably more, but I'll say about 50 languages. But as far as speaking, I would say definitely it's between 15 and 20 that I can actually speak, at least conversational level. Okay, I hope that was thorough enough for you. But yeah, oh yeah, palabra again. He asked me, he said, I'd like to know, have you reached a C level in a few languages? C level, I don't know exactly what. I guess maybe C level was considered like a native level, so I can't say that I reached a C level. Chinese being my best language, I would say I'm at least B2 in that language. That's the highest level I've reached in any of the languages that I've studied. And Japanese, I would say it's like between B1 and B2. Okay, thanks for your question. Next, let me see. Okay, he didn't ask me anything. Let me see. All right, next question by Yanio Montenegro. I say, hola Moises, saludos desde Puerto Rico. I have a two-part question regarding your opinion on international auxiliary languages. International auxiliary languages have been subjected to long-term praise and criticism alike. Advocates claim AILS promote multicultural unity. Objectors claim IALS hasten the extinction of minority languages. Do you believe that in the long term, international auxiliary language are more beneficial than their own? Do you know an international auxiliary language? If so, which international auxiliary language do you know? If not, which auxiliary would you like to learn? Okay, well, first of all, I'm not sure what you mean by international auxiliary languages. Now, you're going to have to be more clear with that. I'm not exactly familiar with that. I guess you're talking about constructed languages, I guess. Like Esperanto, or I'm not sure. Be more specific with your question, and I'll answer it. I will answer that thoroughly next week. Okay? I apologize for that. Okay. Thanks for your question. Nonetheless, just be a little bit more specific with your question, and I'll answer it next week. Okay. How much time we got? Okay. All right. Next question is by Jason Tello. I'm learning French. I spend four to five. I'm assuming you mean hours. 4 to 5 a day when I have school. Any tips for learning French that will let me excel faster? Be very specific. Love your videos. Watch some of the families who was so tired. Okay, thanks for your question, Jason. Excel faster. Well, what advice can I give you for learning French faster? Well, you have to use a approach that will allow you. You have to use an approach that will allow you to learn things faster. I'm not sure what resources you are using. I'm learning French. What resources are you using? And then I can just go off of that. Whatever you're using, I can break it down to you. How you can excel in learning that language. So like Yanyo, the previous commenter, I'm gonna need you to be more specific. Just let me know what resources you're using for learning French, so I can give you better advice on that, on how to go about learning things faster. Okay. All right. Next question. Bye. Next question by Cody, Cody. I'm gonna just call you Cody. Hello again, Moses. I had a few ask me questions. If you wouldn't care to answer them. I just bought the French with Ease course for $50 on Amazon, and I was wondering if you can find them cheaper anywhere else. Also, in the Chinese with Ease course, is there a romanization throughout the whole book? Asimil courses are pretty expensive, man. I'm pretty sure you can find. Now, I don't know if you bought the whole course of $50 or just the book, but there are some websites where you can find them a bit cheaper. Now, I can't give you any websites offhand. I'm pretty sure someone watching this video can let you know. But if you just buy the book, you might be able to get it cheaper. But in general, those awesome courses are very expensive. Very, very expensive. Chinese with Ease. I think they do have romanization throughout the whole book, like pinyin. I think it is. It's accessible in both volumes, I believe. I haven't looked in it for a long time, but I think they do include the pinyin there throughout the whole course. Yep, 22 minutes. All right. Thanks for your question, Cody. If you have any other questions, just post it in this video, and I will get back to that. I will answer it next week. Okay, next question is by Ray K. Pimsleur, Asimil, Teach Yourself, and Colloquial Series all claim to take a learner to an advanced level. Pimsleur and Teach Yourself in particular. Having studied using all these resources, what level do you say they take you to? As many say that these resources don't take you to the level that they actually state. So Pimsleur, Teach Yourself, Colloquial, and Asimil, what levels do they take you to? Okay, thanks for your question, Ray K. I think this is... I don't think one course can take you to see. You have to, in my experience of using these courses, I can't really say that they, like, just one course will take you to an advanced level. You have to use multiple courses. You can't just use one course unless you're using it really, really good. You have a great strategy on using that course to get everything out of it. But you're going to have to use multiple courses. I think PIMS or ASMIL, I think the highest level you'd be taken to, if you just go through the course, probably, maybe I would say a low intermediate level, somewhere around there, like between low intermediate and intermediate. But I don't think advanced, unless you're using it to your, like, you have a really, really good strategy on using that course. It's not going to take you to an advanced level, and I'm not hating either, because I have all those courses. I have Teach Yourselves, I have IC Mills, I have everything, pretty much. See, you know. So, yeah. Yeah. So I would say intermediate. Low intermediate, low between low intermediate, intermediate. If you just like go through the whole course, you know. And you also have to consider the different aspects, reading and writing and speaking. If you're just going through there, just reading and listening to the audio, you may reach those levels in the aspect of comprehension and reading. But if you're not practicing speaking, that's going to be a different case. So, all right. Thanks a lot for your question. I appreciate it. If you have any other questions, post below, and I will get back to it next week. Next question. Wow, this guy doesn't have a name. Huh. Okay, I have a question here, but I can't see this guy's name. But I'm gonna read it. He knows if he watches this video, he knows it's his question. But it says, "Hey Laoshu, I really want to try your method of leveling up, but whenever I see native speakers of my target language, Japanese, I'm too shy to actually talk to them. I feel like I might bother them or make them uncomfortable. How can I overcome this? Thank you." Okay, thanks a lot for your question. Yeah, this is something that, I mean, this is normal. If you never really approach anyone that you don't know and you're trying to speak with them, it's normal because you don't know the reaction. You don't know how they're going to react. And you're going to naturally feel that you're bothering them, or it's just weird to just walk up to someone normally. But you're missing out, I should say. But if you feel this way, I would start off with a chat room. Just spend time in a chat room, hello talk, practicing with native speakers there. And once you get a little more comfortable, start using that the voice, you know, build up your confidence that way, and then you can get out in the battlefield and try it with someone, walk up to them. It's not bad, I'm telling you. In my experience, I have way more good experience of walking up to someone I don't know than bad experiences. I mean, you're going to have some bad experiences, but they're going to be very, very, very low. You're not going to have as many bad experiences as good experience, unless you're just being a jerk or being a douche. And you're not, you know, it all depends on how you approach the people. So, yeah, I would do that. Just start with a chat room, and then build your confidence up, and then get out there and then try it with some people in real life, face to face. Thanks a lot for your question. Let me see. Next question by Vittorio da Regno Unito. Okay, so hi Moses, I'm looking to learn Chinese Mandarin and went to Foyle's bookstore. They had Asimil Chinese with Ease Volume 1. It states you can get to B1 level with this package. What is your thoughts on this? How did you learn Mandarin? I'll wait till I buy it. I've done some online research and they mentioned about not reaching B1 or B2 and speaking with Asimil, but you can get to that level in writing. Okay, thanks a lot for your question. Very good question. So this kind of, my response is pretty much going to be similar to the previous commenter's question. So B1 is possible, I will say. And I think, I don't know, B1 is like, what do they say, B1, B2? That's like, if I'm intermediate. Is B1 low intermediate, B2 like intermediate, high, upper intermediate? I can't remember exactly. But I think in writing and reading, you will reach that level in Asimil. I think that's what they're talking about. But when it comes to speaking, that's a whole different story. That's a whole different story, because that book doesn't have anything to do with speaking, unless you apply that content in your spoken, you practicing with someone on a daily basis. But I think reading, listening, I think you could reach that level in that regard. I learned Chinese differently. I didn't, like I said before about Japanese, these resources weren't accessible to me. Like, I didn't know about Asimil and Teach Yourself. I used some other stuff. I basically had a phrase book, dictionary, and just went out in the field and just spoke with people and just wrote down what I didn't understand, and then went out the next day and did the same thing. that's all I was doing, and I used chat rooms. The resources that you have access to these days, they're very, very good. I mean, they will help out tremendously. And these, I didn't I wouldn't say that they didn't exist back then. I just didn't know about them. So I had to use a different approach on learning learning my languages. Yeah, so thanks for your question, Vittorio. If you have any other questions, post below and I will answer them in next week's quick Q&A video. Let me see. Next question by Shane Danster. 30 minutes. Moses, I'm learning Hi Moses, where are you hoping to travel to this year, and do you find watching TV a waste of time? Thanks. This year I'm going to be traveling around mostly in the US. I don't plan to travel outside the US yet. It may be a possibility in 2018, we'll see, but I have a lot of plans on traveling around to different states in the US for the sake of leveling up and stuff for my footage. Like I want to go to California. I've been to California before, but I want to go back there. California, Florida. I want to go down to Arizona, New York, Wisconsin, several states I want to go to. Several states. Let me see. Oh, is TV a waste of time? I guess it just depends on what you're watching. If you have like if you're into languages and you have language channels like Spanish channel and French channel, whatnot, you can obviously use those as resources to learn and practice your language. It's not, I wouldn't just say it's a waste of time completely, because they do have some useful programs on there. But yeah, that's what I would say. It's not a complete waste of time. I wouldn't say it's a waste of time, because they, like I said, they have some useful stuff that you can, some useful channels that you can watch that will be beneficial to beneficial for your languages. And I mean, they got the science channel and all that stuff. That stuff is pretty entertaining to watch as well, if you like to learn about different animals and you know, different stuff like that. Thanks a lot for your question, Shane. If you have any other questions, post below and I will answer them next week's video. Okay, next question by Robert Stefanko. Moses, I'm learning several languages and I seem to be able to learn them to the intermediate level, and then I feel like I get stuck. I have a hard time with multiple people talking and following a conversation, and I don't seem to catch on to idioms well. I'm curious what your recommendation is in order to continue to improve to the advanced levels. Also, I live just outside Detroit. If you ever come to Detroit again, I would love to go out and level up with you. Thanks for posting your work. It really motivates me, Bob. Thanks for your question, Bob. Great question. Thanks for your support. Thanks for watching my videos. Yeah, I think this problem, being able to follow conversations and catch on to idioms, I think this all comes with experience and exposure. You know, the more exposure you have, the more experience you have with interacting with these natives, the better you will get at catching on to idioms and being able to recognize what's being spoken in the conversation. That you can't learn that in the book. I mean, you can learn some idioms in the book, but nothing beats the experience of the interaction with a native speaker, being around native speakers, just using that language and just hearing them. If you don't understand, if there's something you don't understand, you ask them, they explain to you. You need to be in that type of situation constantly if you want to get better at doing that. That's just how it is. Books won't help you with that in that regard. Yes, definitely, man. Detroit, I want to come up there again. Detroit, I like it. I like it up there. They have a lot of Ukrainian spots, and Ukrainian is one of the languages that I'm going to be messing with this year, and I'm definitely going back up there. Macedonian, Polish, a lot of good stuff up there, a lot of great stuff. You'll know if I plan to go to Detroit when I make a video, because I know anytime I travel for leveling up purposes, I always make a video and let my followers know. Just in case they live there or they're close by, we can like meet up and whatnot. Because I think it's good if you can meet with someone who is more familiar with that area. They can take you around easily and it will save time. So just stay tuned, man. Just keep watching the videos and you'll see. Thanks for your question. And if you have any other questions, just post below and I'll answer them next week. Okay, 35 minutes. We have a lot of questions today, but let me see. Oleg, okay, next question by Oleg Abatini. What resources do you recommend for Indonesian? Usually I use Asimil, but I can't do that for this language because I don't speak French, and Asimil don't sell in Indonesian, of course, for English speakers. Thanks. From an Italian fan living in New York. All right, thanks for your question, Oleg. yeah, I see what you're saying. Asimil is that's actually a great course. I mean, unfortunately, they don't have the English version for Indonesian. But what you could do if you want to continue to use the Asimil is just kind of use Google Translate or some type of translator to translate the French, or actually translate the Indonesian into English or into Italian, your native language. You can do that. Some other resources out there that you could look into are Teach Yourself. There's a colloquial for Indonesian, I believe. And there, I'm pretty sure there's some other. Just go to Google and type in like books, like Indonesian learning resources, and see what you can find. But off the top of my head, I can think of Teach Yourself and colloquial. All right. Thanks for your question, Oleg, and I wish you the best with that. If you have any other questions, post them below and I will answer them next week. Excuse me. All right, Peter Brown, long time no see, man. He wrote in Arabic or something. Hal anta nabati al an ana nafsi nabati mundu sanatein. You asked me, it looked like you asked me, because you asking me something about noun about my health and my something. Ananasi nabati. Yeah, I'm not 100% sure what you're trying to ask me there, Mr. Brown. If you're watching this video, post what your question is here, more clear for me to understand. I don't understand what you're trying to ask me there. I apologize for that. Next question by Wedeleye. Hey Lasha, you talked a little about music in this video, so I wanted to let you know. Oh, he didn't ask me any questions. I'm sorry. All right, next question. What is this? Kuamajoina. It's in Japanese though. Is there a Chinese keyboard that can type traditional and simplified Chinese characters? Thanks for your question. Yes, there is a keyboard. If you download it on your, I'm not sure what version of Windows you use, if you use a Mac, but if you install that, they should have an option to where you can install the language, and they will also show you a virtual keyboard. But see, for Chinese, particularly simplified, you could use Pinyin, which is the easiest form. They have some alternative ways of typing the characters, but those are very difficult and I'm unfamiliar with them. But if you're using Pinyin, you don't have to really worry about a keyboard. It's just, you know, just regular English, just regular English alphabet. Now traditional, I think there's a keyboard that you can use using Pinyin, and they will translate the characters into traditional. You can use that, or you can use the Bopomofo keyboard, which is a system that they use in Taiwan. There's a keyboard for that. I'm pretty sure there's a virtual keyboard. If you install it in your control panel, you'll be able to see this virtual keyboard, and it will show you the actual letters that you will need to type in order to get the character. It's like Japanese. It's like Hiragana or something like that. But I think if you can use Pinyin, I think that would be the easiest way to go, because if you use that Bopomofo keyboard, it's really difficult, because not only do you have to know how to read the characters, you also have to know the tone of the word, and that could be very, very difficult for beginners. But it's up to you how you want to learn. It's up to you. Thanks for your question. If you have any other questions, let me know or just post them below, and I will answer them next week. Okay, Kikansha Thomas. Which languages would you say are your strongest? Let's say top five. In the past, it seemed like Mandarin and Cantonese are your strongest, but it's been a while since I followed your channel. Anyway, let's get in a Street Fighter V setting sometime again. Oh, Thomas, what's up, man? What's going on? Let me see. What's going on, man? What's going on? I would say, you said top five? My top five, I would say Mandarin, Japanese. Let's see, Mandarin, Japanese, Cantonese. Mandarin, Japanese, Cantonese, that's three. I want to say Somali is up there too. Somali. Yeah, Somali's up there. That's four. I'm going through all these different languages right now in my head to see. And probably Spanish. My Spanish is up there too. although I need to practice some more, but yeah. So yeah, those are probably my top five. Those are probably my top five for now. Street Fighter, yeah, man. We definitely have to get some Street Fighter in again. Oh my God, I'm sorry for that. I got knocked off because somebody just tried to call my phone. I was saying that I haven't played Street Fighter for a long time. It's been a very, very long time because I've been very busy. But Will said something. Once I'm available and have some extra time, definitely, man. Most definitely. Let me see. What other questions do I have? Okay, one more question here. This is by Jen Kosuta. Let me see. So hi Moses. I want to learn Hebrew, Arabic, Farsi, and Urdu. Would you recommend an order in which to learn these so that each new one builds on the one before? Arabic, Farsi, and Urdu. Well, I would. If you want to have an easy transition, I would start with Farsi or Urdu because those two are more similar than comparing to Arabic. Arabic is different. You could start off with like Urdu, Hindi, Farsi. Well, Urdu and Hindi, they're pretty much the same language. They're very similar. But I will start off with, if you want to have an easy transition, start with Farsi or Urdu. Do those two and then transition over to Arabic. And then, then Arabic to Hebrew. Because I think Hebrew is more similar to Arabic than Farsi and Urdu. Okay. And I think that's it. We're almost 40 minutes in this video. Those are all the questions. I answered everybody's question. Let me make sure there aren't any other questions below. Yeah, that's all the questions. So again, the rule is if you have a question, post it in this video below and I will answer it in next week's Q&A. It should be Sunday, next Sunday. I like to let at least a week go by to give people a chance to watch the video and answer the question. So that is it. Thanks for viewing, and you guys enjoy the rest of your weekend, and I'll talk to you guys soon. Peace.